Hello. Welcome to today's lecture on deep learning, which will be on the softmax. The softmax is a generalization of the logistic sigmoid, and it will enable us to tackle classification problems with more than just two classes, as in logistic regression. So remember, our model development was we introduced linear regression for prediction of continuous values, so for regression problems. And then we introduced logistic regression, which used the logistic sigmoid to take a linear regression and reduce the output value range from R, so from the range from minus infinity to plus infinity, to the range 0 and 1, which we interpreted as the probability of a single class. And the probability of the other class was then 1 minus that. Now the softmax is a slight generalization of the logistic sigmoid that will allow us to do multi-class classification. As a working example, we are predicting the type of animal from four features. And those are the height, the weight, the speed of those animals, and whether the animal has fur or not. And the post animal labels will either be cat, chicken, or dog. How do we represent those labels? We could, for example, say a 1 is dog, 2 is cat, 3 is chicken. Which would say that cat is more than dog and chicken is more than both of them. So, does this make sense? Probably not. So, because classification problems or multi-class classification problems typically don't have such a natural order, an integer encoding would not be ideal. There's a better encoding, and that is sort of standard in multi-class classification. That's a so-called one-hot encoding, where we're constructing binary vectors of length equal to the number of classes. And all of them are zero, and only one entry is hot, and that's the one for the class. We would have 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, and 0, 0, 1 for dog, cat, and chicken, respectively. Now the problem is, how do we predict sort of outputs for each of those components? Now we have three labels, which means we also need three outputs, which in turn means that we need three functions. So we need a function to predict each of those outputs. In our example, where we have three labels and four features, that means that if we use linear regressions to predict a linear output for each of those label components, that would mean that we need a total of 12 weights, so a weight for each combination of feature and label, plus a bias term for each of the labels. Of course, we can write that a little bit more compactly using vector and matrix notation. If we put O into a vector of length equal to the number of classes, in this case 3, and W into a matrix of size equal to the number of classes times the number of features, and B into a vector equal to the number of classes. We can also represent the whole thing using a neural network diagram, where we observe that we have two layers, an input layer, which represents all the X features, and an output layer that represents all these O's here. And we see that each input is connected to all of the outputs. So the network is fully connected. So it's a fully connected neural network layer. how do we now go from these outputs, which still are continuous, to class labels? Similar to logistic regression, we will try to predict probabilities. However, because we now have more than two classes, this is a little bit more complicated. So what do we need to fulfill in order to get a probability distribution over all of these class labels? It's a discrete probability distribution, which means that all our individual probabilities need to be non-negative and they need to sum to one. And the solution that will allow us to do so is to take our vector O and plug it into the softmax function, which produces us this vector y hat and the components. So each entry in the y hat is the probability of the corresponding class. So y1, y2, y3 in our case, where y1 is the probability of the first class, y2 is the probability of the second class, and y3 is the probability of the third class, such that sum over j, yj equals 1. How does this function look? Well, it's relatively simple. It takes the component, plugs them into an exponential function, so e to the power of the corresponding component, and divides by the sum over e to the jth component, where the sum down here is used to make sure that the sum of these will be 1. The exponential function is by definition always non-negative. So we have ensured that all our components are non-negative, and by normalizing, so by dividing by the sum over these components of the unnormalized components, we have made it sum to 1. And thus the output of this is a proper probability distribution. So why did I say this could be seen as a generalization of the logistic sigmoid? Remember that the logistic sigmoid, we introduced it as pi of our continuous value, which was just a single output, equals 1 divided by 1 plus exp of minus O. Turns out that's the same as exp of O divided by 1 plus exp of O. We said that by symmetry we don't need a second function. Now let's assume we had actually a second function such that 1 equals exp of O2, this is now O1, then this would be equal to the softmax, to the softmax of O1, O2. Because of this redundancy, we didn't need a second function. However, we could have introduced a second function and used the softmax, which would have yielded the same or an equivalent result, just with twice the number of parameters, because we would have had to introduce a second linear function. Now, in principle, you could do the same or a similar thing in the context of multi-class classification. Turns out there's actually always one component that is already determined, given all the remaining ones. So what you could do is you would just say this is one plus that. And then you basically can model one more class. Now in practice, that is not done, and empirically for sort of large number of classes, the number of parameters also is not very different. So for simplicity, we just introduce a single function per class. In order to predict then one class, the most sensible thing to do is to predict the most likely class, which would be the argmax over all the output values, or equivalently the argmax over all the probabilities, because the softmax function yields the same argmax. OI and YI have the same max. Summarizing the computation in terms of matrices and vectors. So for the ith training example, we first take the feature vector of that training example, multiply it by the weight matrix, add the bias vector, and that gives us the vector of these continuous class values for the ith example. This vector we plug then into the softmax to get the probabilities for that ith example to belong to the corresponding classes given x. Now, if you don't have just a single example, but n of them, for example, a mini batch of size n, then x is not a vector anymore, but for the whole batch or mini batch, that would be a matrix of size n times d. If you also have q output categories or classes, then x is an n by d matrix. So it's a matrix that has one row per training example, and w now has d rows and q columns, so it has one row per feature and one column per category. And b finally is a vector of length q. And then O now also becomes a matrix. It's a matrix that is now length n by q. And this is given by O equals the matrix product x, the matrix x times the matrix w plus b. And this is an abuse of notation because it implicitly assumes that b is broadcasted, so that the vector b is broadcasted to each row. And then we take this matrix O and plug it into the softmax function to then get a matrix y hat, where each row of this matrix corresponds to the matrix of length n rows and q classes, and each row corresponds to the probability distribution of the class. So it has a row sum of 1, each row sums to 1. Note that the columns do not sum to 1, so only the rows are normalized. And of course, this softmax output corresponds to a probability distribution of y given x. So it's for the ith training example, this is the probability of yi, example belonging to the ith category, given the feature vector xi. We are again assuming that they're all independent but not identically distributed, because they do differ in the feature vectors, so the conditional distributions are different. Conditional distribution y given x, our likelihood, factorizes over the training examples. And correspondingly, we can write down a negative log likelihood. So minus log p of capital Y given capital X equals the sum over all the likelihoods of individual data points. And because they're independent, you have the product and the likelihood and the sum and the log likelihood and the negative log likelihood correspondingly. Because we're doing machine learning, we're again minimizing a loss function instead of maximizing a likelihood. Otherwise, we could have left out this minus here. So this yields a loss function for each training example, which is minus log of p hat, so the predicted likelihood of that training example, which is given by minus the sum over all the q classes, so it's j equals 1 through q, yj, the label for that, so it's the jth component of a one hot vector, times log of the jth component of the output of our softmax. So this is our predicted probability, and this is the label. So this means that by construction, y consists of all zeros, but only a single one for the correct label, which means that all but one of the components in the sum becomes zero. So what we're left with is only the log of the predicted probability of the correct class. So thus is still the negative log likelihood, in case you have wondered why we were summing over all the classes. Because all the log yj's have to be smaller or equal to zero, this means the theoretical minimum to the log likelihood would be obtained if all the predicted likelihoods were equal to one. Now this can only for linear functions, this is only the case if our samples are actually linearly separable. If that is not the case, this is not even possible on the training data set. But this would sort of be the theoretical minimum. If we could completely separate our data point, then we would always yield a model that assigns sort of training data likelihoods of one for each data point. Now let's compute the derivatives. First, let's look at the loss a little bit closer for a single sample. The loss equals minus the sum over all the components yj times log of yj. Now, if we plug in the softmax, this becomes minus j yj times log of exp of oj divided by sum over k exp of ok. The log cancels with this, so we basically get yj times oj. And then the division becomes a minus with the log, so we get minus yj times log of the sum of the exponent of these ok's. So this is what we see here. This is the first component, so it's minus minus. This is what was under. If I repeat it again, exp yj log exp of oj divided by sum over k exp of ok. So the log turns this into a minus, this cancels with this minus. So this is this corresponds to this part here multiplied by yj, right? So it's yj log over the sum down here minus sum over j yj log of exp cancels. What's left is oj. Yeah. And this now equals to log of the sum over k exp of ok, because only a single of these components in y equals 1, the remaining one are 0, minus sum over j, yj, oj. Now if we look at the derivative of that with respect to the output, then what we get is derivative of the first term here, this becomes this fraction. So this again looks like the softmax itself minus yj. So this is softmax of oj minus yj, which means that this equals to the probability of y equals yj minus yj. Looking at this term, this is actually quite similar to the residual that we have seen for linear regression. In linear regression with the squared loss, we had something like our linear function of the x minus the regression label as a residual. So the derivative in some sense looks similar to the derivative of linear regression. And the point is that there's actually a sort of an underlying reason for that. And that is that we have seen that the linear regression corresponded to a Gaussian log likelihood or Gaussian likelihood. And this here corresponds to a multinomial likelihood. Now, both of these models are exponential families. So if you're familiar with that, you would see a similar derivative for all exponential family models. Now say, instead of classes, we actually had labels were vectors that itself are distributions. Say, for example, we get a distribution over cat, chicken, and dog of 0.1, 0.2, 0.7 as a label. So there's already uncertainty in the labels. It turns out that we can do the same thing with are lost for our multi-class problem. If we write down the same loss that we had before, just instead of binary yj's, we plug in our probabilities here, we can work still with the same loss. Just the interpretation changes, because what this is, if we pull in the minus here, then it's the sum over yj times the log over the yj's. And because yj is now a probability distribution, what we actually have is something like probability of yj times the log of our predicted probabilities. So it's the predicted probabilities, our likelihoods. So this is basically the expected value of the negative log likelihood. Now this loss function is called the cross entropy loss, and it's sort of the canonical loss for classification problems. Now cross entropy has entropy in its name. What is the entropy? The entropy is called capital H. It's evaluated on probability distribution. So the entropy of a probability distribution equals the sum over all the components of this probability distribution minus this probability times log of that probability. That formula you may already recognize as something that is very similar to our cross entropy loss. Now, entropy is a key concept in information theory because it's related to sort of the problem of compression. So it's sort of the minimum number of nets, where nets in and as a analogous to bits. So if the log here was base 2, then this would be bits. This would be equivalent. So if we would define the entropy with log 2, we would get bits here. So it's the number of nets needed to encode this distribution. Related to that is the Kalbach-Leibler divergence, or KL divergence. It's a distance measure between two distributions. And the Kalbach-Leibler divergence of between P and Q, where it's important what the order is, because it's not a symmetric distance, equals the sum over, again, of all the components, P of J times log of P divided by Q. And now if we take the log, then we will see that we get log of P minus log of Q, and P times log of P is the entropy, and what is left is P times log of Q. So what this means is that if we compare this to our cross entropy here, the cross entropy really is the KL divergence between the true distribution, our label distribution, and our predicted distribution, plus a constant term, which is the entropy. If we minimize this loss, we are basically minimizing the KL divergence between our label distribution and a true distribution. So that's why it's called sort of the cross entropy loss. So let's summarize this part. We introduced the softmax, which takes a vector of continuous values. So for example, the outputs of q different linear regressions, and turns them into a probability distribution. It has q components. And that allows us to treat multi-class classification problems, where Q is the number of our classes. So these are, this probability distribution is now the probability of each class. The softmax operation ensures that all of them sum to one and that they are all non-negative. Cross entropy is a good measure of the difference between two probability distributions because it's basically up to a constant related to the KL divergence. So it measures also the number of bits needed to encode the data given our model. So if you in the entropy replace one of the p's by q, you have also the cross entropy model, cross entropy loss. And with this, I want to conclude for the day. And in fact, I want to conclude our lecture series on shallow learning models. Next time, we will start with the series that is actually more related to the name of the whole course, which is deep learning. So we will start with actually multi-layer architectures. So see you next week. Bye-bye.